Okay, so here we are. Summer's over, and we are at September 28th. So it's late in the summer, early autumn, and the bees are working on asters and other flowering plants on my property. So I thought I would just make a video, and we'll walk around and see where they're getting their nectar and where they're getting their pollen resources. These are asters. Asters come in a variety of colors. And a good stop to start off with would be the landing boards in the apiary. So we're going to look at the different landing boards, and I notice that they are all bringing in pollen. That's a good sign. We want them to have brood, and we want those brood to be strong going into winter. And I also pay attention to where the foragers are flying off to. It kind of helps me go and scout it out myself and see what kind of flowers they might be on. So we're just going to walk around some of the plants I've added this year to bridge the time of year when we've lost pollen and nectar might be in decline. They definitely forage on white clover throughout the year. And now we're going to look at some of the other floral sources. This is a box that has a feeder on top of it. It is the only hive box and colony in my apiary that's being fed, and that's because they're a late season swarm. This is my tiger colony, I call it, and they are bringing in lots of pollen, but notice that it's different colors and coming from different sources. So I'm going to walk you out in my lower meadow here, and we're going to see what they're on. Get a close-up of the landing board and just see the activity levels. Since I've shot this film, we have dropped in temperature quite a bit. So I've put screen entry reducers on all of the colonies now, so that the yellow jackets, which are prolific this year, cannot easily get into these colonies. Now these are purple asters, and this is a honeybee on it, of course. And mostly, and this is an orchard bee. I like seeing them, and look at all the pollen this tiny bee has on its hind legs. And again, these are asters. Orchard and mason bees are all over. These are native pollinators. And we have a lot of asters because I've let them grow throughout the years. You can just hear all the bees. And this, of course, is another honeybee, super loaded with pollen. And notice that the pollen that's on its legs looks darker than the pollen that's on the flower, and that's because they mix it up with nectar, and they add some color to it on their own. This is, of course, the monarch butterfly, and again on asters, so pollinators of a variety of different species benefit from the flowers that we allow to grow. And this year, the monarchs have made a really good comeback. Now, these yellow flowers are a native sunflower variety. They're called Maximilian Sunflowers. And they grow to 8 feet in height on average. And this is something that I think is very valuable at the end of the summer, because they come into bloom when other floral resources are going into decline. So Maximilian Sunflowers are fantastic. Next year we'll be doubling the amount of area that we're dedicating to this plant. Lots of pollen and loaded with nectar. You can really tell when a flower has lots of nectar by the amount of time the pollinators spend on each blossom. Either they're gathering a lot of pollen, and that takes time, but notice like this monarch butterfly sticking its tongue down there and spending a lot of time collecting nectar. Also, when you cut off one of the blooms and hold it in your hand, they're heavy. So this nectar release continues in tiny bits throughout the day, and that's to keep the pollinators returning to the same blossoms over and over. Now, of course, even though the monarch is considered a pollinator, It does not itself eat pollen. It is really only after the nectar, and they just become a carrier for that pollen from plant to plant, flower to flower. It's a little bit windy today, so these blossoms are moving around on me, and they are on long stalks, so it is a little bit of a challenge to track them here with the camera. But I wanted you to see how well these insects are utilizing the pollen and nectar resources on these flowers. Now, Maximilians are native to the state of Pennsylvania, where I reside, and they're native to many other states in the United States. I purchased these from Eden Brothers, is the name of the website, if you want to check them out. I also source my sunflowers from them, and they're available online. They sell a lot of open pollinated plants, and they're a primary source if I'm buying seed. Here again is a monarch butterfly now on asters. And they don't spend so much time on the blossoms because each blossom only yields so much nectar. And they go blossom to blossom fairly quickly. Now, if you were to run your fingers across these little leaves on the Maximilian sunflowers here, they feel kind of like sandpaper or like a cat's tongue. So they're very rough if you're trying to identify them early before they've blossomed out. And of course, the honeybees are working them. More and more, the honeybees are moving from the asters and concentrating more on these Maximilian sunflowers. So again, as the other floral resources are in decline, the Maximilians are coming in, and they're going to continue to provide nectar and pollen to the honeybees for several weeks yet. Here we are back on the asters, and you can just listen and hear all the honeybees that are working these flowers. This, of course, does produce aster honey. Goldenrod also produces its own honey, and it's pretty strong, kind of granular, so it tends to solidify or crystallize quicker than some other sources. And of course, the honeybees are still working the white clover, even though I haven't taken the time here to show you that. Now, there is floral constancy when it comes to honeybees. They go to one species only on a flight. But I guess they do consider the asters, purple or white, to be the same species, because I did notice these honeybees jumping directly from purple asters to white asters. Now we're back on goldenrod. Goldenrod, as I mentioned before, is a great source of honey this time of year, and my hives are filling up with honey. All the flow supers are at 80 or 90%. They're ready to be drawn off in the coming week. I'm just waiting for a really nice warm day to do that. But, and as you can see, there's plenty of brown on this goldenrod, so it is kind of getting to the end. I expect we'll be out of goldenrod honey here within the next week. And again, notice how little time the bee spends on each flower. Moves quickly, and that's an indicator that there's a very little nectar there. And here we are back in the Maximilian sunflowers, and notice how much time the honeybee spends on each blossom. They're really loaded. And of course, we want a really strong brood going into fall, because the winter bees are going to come from the upcoming brood, and the pollen is really going to be the greatest indicator of their success, their health. excellent and healthy and big and active they are going into fall and winter. And that's what we really want, and one of the reasons we take the time to establish late season pollen resources. I started these flowers from seed in the spring. We did till down a section and rolled them in. And so this is a first year yield with these Maximilian sunflowers, and they are perennial, so they'll continue on their own without requiring reseeding, which is something I like. I'm all about low maintenance. Now, something that people always ask is, what can we do to improve the survivability of pollinators across the nation? And that is looking at this fence row. That's a field of soybeans in the background there. But by allowing wildflowers like these asters to grow along hedgerows and to have these wild areas, instead of just mowing them down, definitely provides resources for the pollinators, and not just the honeybees, but butterflies, mason bees, wasps, any number of other insects are going to benefit if we allow these wild areas to continue between farmer crop fields. I think it's very, very important, and if you're looking for something to do, then allow some of your rough areas to grow up and make sure to plant some wildflower seeds there. Here we are back on goldenrod, and if you'll notice, this is a wasp. Now, some people often claim that wasps and flies are also native pollinators, and that's true. This year I will say, though, that the yellow jackets are terrible, and they're really taking their toll on the honeybees. And we want to work kind of against the yellow jackets in favor of the honeybees. This is a ladybug, of course, getting into the nectar. Ladybugs also eat aphids and other pest insects, so they're nice to have around. And here again is a yellowjacket wasp, and notice their bodies are slick. But look underneath the thorax, they have a lot of fuzz there, and this particular wasp is showing that it does carry pollen. Incidentally, of course, underneath its thorax, and it rubs itself all over these flowers as it tries to get the nectar out, which shows how the yellowjacket wasp is indeed a pollinator. I don't know if the pollination benefit outweighs the aggression that they show. Thanks for watching. Hope you learned something. Grow wildflowers, and if you don't have them and you're in the north, grow Maximilian sunflowers for a late season crop. Thanks again.